I'm a little shaky tonight, I don't mind telling you. I know some of you are thinking, you know, she's looking bad these days. She used to be so cute. What happened? I'll tell you. I had a very traumatic year. Two horrifying things have happened to me. One, I moved house. Moving people came, moved me, and pointed to a bucket full of 1,000 Lego pieces and said, "This is your furniture. For more money, we'll put it together again." I said, "No, I like it in a powder form, so I can snort it and imagine sitting down." Then the minute you move in, builders appear. I don't even need builders, but they've hatched all over my house like cockroaches. Hundreds of them, taking down walls, putting up walls, replacing walls, eating walls. They've taken away my husband and had him rehung. Well, he needed it. The children have been completely repainted. Everything's been repainted. Have you tried to buy paint these days? You go to get some paint and they give you, "Oh no, you can't just have a simple beige. There's 1,000 different beiges." Evolution has taken place in the world of beige and they have advanced beyond all recognition. There's soft mushroom dusky natural beige, powdery dusky tawny tannish beige, Tijuana beach beige, soft sandy peachy tony sun buffy Mexicana desert sunset beige. Or the new weedy, dusky Arizona clam chowder creamy coffee beige. And you become obsessed. My friend called me, he's very ill. He was going on about how someone had found him a donor kidney. I said, "Yeah, yeah, yeah. But did you know I found the new creamy Casablanca beige?" He hung up. What does he know? The number two tragedy in my life is my nanny decides to get married. I let her out of the house once in 4 years and she gets engaged. You know, I have two children and I know nothing about child rearing. I'll come out of the closet. I know where the food goes in, but where it comes out, I don't want to know. So with all my problems, I thought I'd simplify my life, bring my home life to work. You know, I told you my nanny's getting married. So I said, why not do it on the show? Get it all over with at once. She won't have to pay for the video. I won't have the hassle of scraping wedding cake off my new okra red Indian off tan with a dribble of peach beige carpet. So this is the lovely bride, Julia. Don't be nervous. And this is the lovely groom, Johnny. You sure you want to marry her? No, I'm just kidding. He's a big fella. Good wallet-bearing hips. Julia, come on, hide. He shouldn't see you before the wedding.
Get on with it.
Oh, I forgot. I'd now like to welcome this week's co-host.
No.
Jennifer Saunders.
No. No. No.
Problem?
Yeah. We agreed this week I wasn't going to be called your co-host. I'm just the bridesmaid, all right?
Jennifer, the print was there. All you had to do was use a magnifying glass.
Oh,
you would have seen it.
Can I just say, Julia, can you come out here a moment? This is Julia. This really is Ruby's nanny. She's not an actress, is she?
No.
For 4 years, she has worked her fingers to the bone for you, and now, of course, she has her wedding courtesy of BBC props. That's lovely. Thanks, Rube. I shall now pick up her hugely expensive train. Cue music, action!
That's the last time we used Jennifer. We could have had bigger stars. Jane Seymour begged for that part. Okay, could you keep it quiet back there? I'd like to introduce my first guest tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome, who else could it be? Shelley Winters. When I was a little girl, I had this image of... This was the first woman I ever saw that had guts. And so she was my heroine ever since. Were you called the blonde bombshell? Because I
yes.
Did you act kind of...
Yes, they used to give you lessons, and they would put tape on your face so you would practice a cry. They didn't want you to really cry. They put drops in your eyes, and they put scotch tape on your face so you wouldn't wrinkle up your face when you were acting. And then they would teach you things like how to sit.
Oh, really?
Yeah, all those, you know.
But you did the first open mouth smile.
Yes, I did.
Well, I did that
because I had buck teeth. And once my friend Marilyn was at, she worked at 20th and I worked at Universal, and she came into the room where they took pictures. You had to, if you weren't working on a movie, you had to take stills all
day long. This is Marilyn Monroe.
Yes.
Because you lived together for a year.
Yeah, we did. And we were friends for a long time, since her name was Norma Jean. She used to talk like that. I mean, and I was never a soft-spoken person. And I used to say, what? And she saw me posing with my unbucked teeth, and she said, that's very sexy. And I said, is it all? You do it. I think it's stupid. And I tried posing with my mouth closed. And she, forever after, posed like this. She did it better.
When you lived with her, you used to make lists of all the men you really wanted. And
yeah.
On your list
well,
was...
Well, after the Second World War, we said, well, the double standard is over. Little did we know. So we ought to, just like men do, make lists of people we would like to have love affairs. I don't know. Do people have love affairs now, or are they just screw?
Yeah, they do.
Sunday mornings, we would get culture. We would listen to Bach and Beethoven, and they used to sell... records with little books, you know, of culture. And we decided one day we should make lists of the attractive men that we knew that we would love to have love affairs with. And we took an hour, and then we showed each other our lists. There wasn't one man on her list under 50. she thought white hair was sexy.
She had Albert Einstein on it.
Yeah, Albert Einstein. I think she made it.
Stuff. Really?
Yes. How did he think of the theory of relativity?
He was inspired.
She inspired him.
What goes up must keep going up.
Yes, that's right. Something like that.
What was Bert like? What was Marlon?
Well, you know, once, after I'd written the book, I met Marlon Brando. He was running on a street. I lived near him. And he said, you didn't say that I was number 10 in the book. And I said, well, I couldn't. I was married to Vittorio Gassman, a great... Italian star, I have his child. He had to be number 10. And he looked at me and he said, you lie. Boy, you forgot. You lie.
When your waters broke, he came to pick you up on
yes.
a motorcycle?
Oh, yes. My goodness. I was having a baby, and my husband was in Italy. He was in Genoa doing Hamlet. Hamlet. I don't know why, I just didn't know what that was. I didn't know what happened.
And Nobody knows.
And it, when it happens, you think, well, you know, did I pee? What happened? Or did the baby pee? He was shooting a picture with a friend of mine about the guys on the motorcycles. I can't remember it.
You mean the wild ones?
Yeah, the wild ones. And I called the set, and it was, I don't know, 12 o'clock at night. And... I said, Marlon, I know you're the lead in the picture, but is Jerry there? And I said, Marlon, something very strange happened. Maybe I should go to the hospital. I'm not having pain, but... And I described it. He told me, your water broke. And I said...
Marlon knows.
He knew. He said, I'm coming over, and I'll take you on the motorcycle to the hospital. I said, you are not... I said, you're not going to take me on a motorcycle. When we got to the hospital, they put me in a wheelchair, and they said, which one's the father? I said, none of them. But you know, it was strange. I went into the hospital on the 12th, and I remember I wouldn't allow her to be born on Friday the 13th. That's how superstitious. And I crossed my legs till the morning of Friday, of Saturday morning of the 14th. My daughter is born on Valentine's Day.
You mean she was pushing?
I was pushing her back. I wouldn't let her.
Wow.
I crossed my legs. The doctor said 40 years of delivering babies. He never saw anybody do that.
That is very flat.
Yes.
And when you won the Oscar, they said you were crawling.
I won twice.
I know, but one time you were leaving already.
Oh, yes. No, I was nominated for Place in the Sun, Best Actress. And I was sure I won. I had made a dress. My mother and I had made a dress, and Vittorio brought me. And I swear till this time, I swear to God, I heard him say Shelley Winters and not Vivian Lee. I heard him.
And
I was halfway up the stairs. And Vittorio tackled me. And I said, "You crazy wop, what are you doing?" I won the Oscar, I gotta go up there and get it. Those were the days.
I hope you don't mind me saying, but still in the early days, you went out with, was it Yvonne DiCarlo to, it was Clark Gable and
she
Errol
really
Flynn.
Read this book.
I read it three times, it's stained already.
Did you make love to your husband while you were reading
it? I was aroused, I made love with everybody
there,
but my
another
husband.
Another baby. What'd you say?
But there was that wonderful story. Did you end up with
Errol Flynn? I'll tell you quickly. Yvonne DiCarlo was under contract to Universal, and one night she invited me to dinner at Errol Flynn's house. We get there, and there was a famous agent, very handsome, Charles Feldman, and Clark Gable and Errol Flynn. Can you imagine it, girls? We had some drinks, and then we went to this gorgeous gold bathroom, and Yvonne DiCarlo said to me, "Which one do you want?" And I said, "What are you saying?" She said, "Well, who do you want, Clark Gable or Errol Flynn? Can you imagine such a thing?" And I thought about it, and Clark Gable was, like Laurence Olivier, was an idol. And I said, "Errol Flynn." I know.
I can't believe it.
But I never regretted it. I never regretted it. Errol Flynn was so handsome and so elegant. And as we were sitting watching this movie, some wall slid back, and I looked over, and there was sort of an alcove with a bed with satin, a beige satin sheets, and a mirror in the ceiling. Doesn't this happen to English girls?
No! You want to be in the Royal Shakespeare Company? Are you crazy?
Anyway, I think I lost a weekend there somehow. I remember it well, that was Friday night, and I got back to the studio Monday morning.
That's wonderful.
Now, we can't talk about my love life anymore,
no.
My non-existent love life.
Well, when did you stop having a love life?
I didn't wait till there was a problem about AIDS. Right. I think I quit around herpes.
Why'd you stop, though?
She has a great sex life. Can't you tell? You know. This is what I got to look at, not the audience. Okay.
How do you know I have a great sex life?
I can just tell. You have that glow.
Really?
Yes, and you got two kids.
I got a lot of makeup on.
No. That's a different glow. You can't fake that. It comes from the eyes.
Well, you have a glow, so you must be doing something.
No, different.
No.
I eat too much.
When did you start binging? And, you know, you said you were binging and dieting.
When I stopped making love.
You don't have so much chutzpah.
No, I don't.
No, I'm kidding.
Not anymore. No, I don't. I think I did. I think it leaks away. But you're giving me inspiration. I am going to start writing again. It's really wonderful what you're doing.
Thanks
it's
for
amazing.
Being on the show.
Yeah, on Roseanne, they say, now we're going to see the writers, and 16 people come down. You're the sole writer of this whole show. Thank you
Thanks,
for inviting Shelley. Me.
Thank you. A lot of people have written in asking if Taffy Turner is indeed a man. That's a toughie. See if you can spot any facial hairs. Here she is, Taffy, or is it Teddy Turner?
Hello, Ruby in London. This is Taffy Turner outside America. I'm late for a very important date with Mrs. Windsor.
Taffy Turner, Taffy Turner, Taffy Turner, Taffy Turner, Taffy Turner, outside America.
Hat and gloves. Today I'm on a mission. I'm going to speak to Diana, Princess of Wales, not just because it would be a journalistic coup, but because I feel an undeniable psychic connection to her. Surprising? Not really. We have both risen from obscurity into intense, unbelievable public perusal and upsetment. So look out, Diana. I've got your schedule, and here I come. Let's go. Come on, put your foot to the metal, buddy. Let's go. She's right in front of us. come on. I think she's just been at Marks and Spencer. Let's find out what she bought. I heard you just waited on Princess Di, Princess of Wales.
God, am I on the telly?
Yes, you are.
God, I'm ashamed.
Don't!
You do, yeah?
Was Princess of Wales here?
Yeah, about 5 minutes ago,
and
yeah.
What did she buy?
She didn't buy nothing. She brought back 30 pairs of knickers.
30 pairs? Did you look at anything?
Oh, the firm control over there.
Oh, yeah. The firm controls. These?
Yeah, yeah.
I thought she was so thin. Why would she need firm control?
Well, she had children, you know what I mean?
Well, a little extra fun. Yeah. I guess it wouldn't hurt. Thanks, bye.
Hey, girl, where are you going with this?
I can see the top of her head. It's gleaming like a halo. She has been a bit of a saint, hasn't she? What with big ears? Here we are at St. Mary's Hospital. Diana's doing one of her charity visits. Here's her car. Is she in there? No, dang. Oh, look. Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother Wing. We're at the right place. Come on. She's in one of these rooms, I think. I hope she hasn't left yet. Here it is. Fine. Let's go. Oh, she's gone. Was Princess Di here? Just nod your head. Yes, she was. Did she live within the last 5 minutes? What are you doing? I have to get some questions answered here. Did she live in the last 5 minutes? Nod your head. Just nod your head.
Good,
thank you. I walked in. How do you think? You'll hear from the BBC, young lady.
What do you mean there's been a change in schedule?
Okay. Great, thanks. She's gone to the Kensington Hilton. Let's go. Just 1 second, Diana, please talk to me. Just a second, please, please. I've been looking everywhere for you. Open this door. Diana, please talk to me. I beg of you. Well, you're not leaving. Not until you give me an interview. I've been looking for you all day. I'm not leaving until you grant me an interview. You hear? Ah!
That was the scene in central London earlier today as BBC reporter Taffy Turner was physically removed from the bonnet of Princess Diana's limousine. Surprising? Not really. Turner is an American who claims she has an exclusive interview with the princess, but Buckingham Palace officials deny any knowledge of that arrangement.
Well, apparently Princess Di doesn't know what side her bread is buttered on. The press has always been pro-princess, and so have I. But I want her to know that I forgive her, and if she needs me, I'm number 3409. This has been Taffy Turner, inside jail, outside America, so you don't have to be. Bye-bye.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered together here in the sight of God and in the face of this congregation to join together this man and this woman in holy matrimony, which is an honorable estate.
Jennifer, what do you think of this wedding?
Wow.
I believe in not spending a lot of money on the ceremony in case things don't work out. You know, so you don't choke on the memory of spending $8,000 on sculpted eggs once he's run off with the babysitter. I say give it 20 years when you really run out of conversation. And if he's still there when you turn around in bed, call the caterers. I mean, I don't even buy a car unless it goes on trial. Why should a husband be different? Take less time thinking about doily settings and more time sniffing around the bottom of his drawers. That's my advice to you young brides. Don't be blinded by all that flying confetti. Jennifer, can you believe she's leaving me for a man with that sheep excuse she has to get married? Couldn't he wait till the kids grow up?
If any man or woman knows why these two people may not be joined together in holy matrimony, speak now or forever after hold thy peace.
I've got to go see if they're talking about me. I'll be right back.
Oh, Julia looks lovely. Could have been worse. She could have got married on Challenge Annika, I suppose. So, you know, it's not all Ruby's fault. I mean, Ruby and motherhood, it's like an allergy to her. Brings her out in this rash and her nipples drop off. That's another sad thing. When the news of Julia leaving went out on that nanny network, Ruby's house was inundated with letters from poor couples from Romania and Azerbaijan offering to adopt her children.
Sorry, I'm sorry, sorry, sorry. Were you talking about me while I was gone? I hate when you do that. Jennifer, the job is, and I repeat, sitting in the kitchen and looking vaguely amused at things I say. Instead, I turn my back and you just yabber away.
Do you?
Oh my God. Oh my God, they're doing the wedding vows. Oh,
just do them. I'll hold it here. I've got them. Let's do them.
From this day forward, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health, till death do you part.
I do.
I now pronounce you man and wife. You may kiss the bride.
Sorry. Sorry to interrupt you. I may have lost a nanny, but I still have a career. So now it's time for a film. You connect during it. No, not all of you. Anyway, each week I take my guests out to dinner to get a kind of warmth and rapport going before they get on the show. This week I had a kind of a hiccup with Katherine Helmond. Roll the film.
What you are about to see is a true story, a true crime story. All the characters you will meet are real people. Only their noses have been altered slightly to improve their career prospects. On Wednesday, the 12th of February, 1993, Ruby Wax, a television personality, went to London's famous Dorchester Hotel to take one of the guests on her show out to lunch, an actress called Katherine Helmond. They were to discuss the interview she would do on Ruby's show the following day. So far, nothing was unusual.
God, could you get rid of that cigar?
p.m. and Ruby Wax and Katherine Helmond were seen entering a taxi. The hotel doorman reported that Miss Helmond was behaving like one of those South American tribesmen when they've smoked those dreadful pipes and believe lizards are eating them alive.
All right. Don't say a word. Don't say a word. They cost a fortune, and they are very in.
I see your point. Let's go.
Where to, please?
Okay, that's it. Come on, out of the car. Out. What are you doing, Katherine?
Spread them. Nobody where to's me.
Katherine.
I know what you're after.
Katherine, what's he done?
Oh, he knows what he's done. He's the jerk with the lipstick on your forehead. You come here. It's him. I know it's him.
Katherine.
He's the one.
Katherine, don't talk to him. He'll just bore us to death and give us a pamphlet.
You sold me that incense in Los Angeles, stank up the whole house. Even the dog had to come out with a white flag.
Come on, Katherine. Come on. Go away
now. It's definitely him. Same haircut, same colored sheet. Same jingling bells, same stupid grin.
Come on, Katherine, get in the car now. It's him,
I tell you.
Did you take us to Animos on Charlotte Street?
This is nice. I love Greek food. 12:44 p.m. and things were not going so well. In fact, they were taking a turn for the worse. Ruby was beginning to realize this lady would be difficult to interview and probably impossible to tie down to a chair. Oh, do move over, Ruby! You're crushing my legs!
What is the stuffed zucchaca? I hope it doesn't taste what it sounds like.
I am a pagan!
Yes! Katherine, don't humiliate yourself.
I must dance.
Don't humiliate yourself. Oh, Katherine, look, you've stepped in the tongues a lot. It's time to go home. Please stop.
They love me. The Greeks,
Katherine,
they
you'll
do.
You'll thank me for this.
I knew this would end in tears. The Terramo Salata was completely ruined. It was February the 13th, the day of the interview with Ruby. Katherine wasn't her old self. As a matter of fact, she was dead. Dead as old carp lying belly up in a pond. No use to anyone, really, except perhaps as a doorstop.
I think she just tore a muscle. She'll be fine.
Darling. I know these stars of old with the little habits. We did Liza Minnelli. Darling, I had to scrape her off the ceiling. She was down there sniffing the dandruff. I did Liz. Need I say more?
Curiouser and curiouser.
She's had enough
room. Ruby's attempt to cover up Katherine Helmond's death
had
so far succeeded. But would she be able to fool the viewing public? Katherine herself was beginning to curl.
Don't help us. No. What?
She's telling me a little joke. She's so funny. No, please don't come near us. Look at her. She's waving. She's waving. Fine. Fine now, okay? I'll just rehearse a little bit and then...
Okay, here we go. 3, 2, 1, on title.
Where are you going? Can you get out of my way?
Ladies and gentlemen, I guess you've all seen Lynn Redgrave with her show Fighting Back, where famous people come on and talk about their illnesses. Well, my next guest beats them all. It's Katherine Helmond in a coma because of a food allergy. She just can't eat a walnut and get away with it. The darnest thing. What? What is this? What are you doing? What have I done?
She was having a snooze on my show. What's the problem here? This isn't my fault. This is yours. You with that cigar and that irritating voice. This wouldn't have happened if you weren't following me around with a camera crew day and night. Put out that cigar!
At 9 p.m., Ruby Wax was arrested for the first-degree murder of Katherine Helmond, actress. Ruby got life. I got a large check and a spin-off series.
Julia? Julia, come back to me.
No. Go. Julia, go. God knows what kind of life you can make for yourself out there. Constantly looking over your shoulder, constantly on the move, having to change your name, having to undergo major plastic surgery, living like many of us do with that constant fear that one day Ruby Wax will be standing on your doorstep.
No, go on, forget about me. Go on, forget about it. Julia? Julia, but if anything goes wrong, like those things I heard about him are true. Remember, I am here for you. Desperate and suicidal. But here. Julia!
Julia, throw the bouquet! She paid for the bouquet! She'll sue! Throw the bouquet! Throw the bouquet!
What did I get this for? I've already been married to everybody.
Julia! I'll give you more money and a fridge of your own! Take as much as you can catch! No time limit!
Before I leave, I found you a French au pair. You want to see her?
Yeah. Who is it?
Jean Moreau.
John who?
Jean. She smokes, she can't drive, and she won't live in.
And I don't deal with nappies.
Book her.